Take the hands up.
Oh, I think I'm going to faint.
You do, you'll fall on your ear. The pretty lady. Come here.
Who? Me?
No, the other pretty lady.
Oh, for pity's sake.
Come here. Everybody get back in the car. You have nothing to fear.
I don't.
In the coach. Come on, in the coach.
Give
him
up. I don't know how you lived so long and act so foolish, my friend. Oh, horse tell it to us.
He's very pretty friend you got. He looked very beautiful on my girl. I take him. But first I give you coal for him.
Just say, gracias, gracias.
Come. Keep him up.
You didn't rob any of us.
Lady. I never robbed the individual. I am so sorry. I cannot travel with you in this very dangerous country. But I wish you a very safe and pleasant journey. Adios.
Goodbye, Bandit.
Get on your way. Quick.
You are listening to TMBDOS. They must be destroyed on sight. The following podcast about film often contains foul language, discussions of an adult nature, and spoilers for the films discussed are to be expected. Now take it away, Dr. Rausch.
They must be destroyed on sight!
Welcome. It is They Must Be Destroyed on Sight, episode 199. So yeah, we're one away from 200. And I'm your host, Lee. So smart he'd dry snow and sell it as sugar, Russell. And joined by my co-host, Daniel. That's why they have rubbers on lead pencils, Harper. How you doing, sir?
I'm doing... What? Oh, sorry, my browser did something. I'm doing fine. I said my browser just decided to upgrade something for another reason. When I was, it just flashed up just as you asked me to talk, and suddenly I thought I had left the stream because technology is garbage, and we rely on it for our lives. Mm-hmm. We're all stuck inside, except you and I are not, because we are quote unquote essential workers, mm-hmm. which means we are easily exploitable. But we're still making podcasts, at least sometimes. So it's gonna be fun.
Yeah, at least I'm being exploited in a socialist utopia. So I'm making yes. a little bit extra money.
The socialist utopia of Nova Scotia.
Yeah. So you know.
Yes. Do you still have toilet paper there? Do you have to stand in line for toilet paper?
No. There's plenty of toilet paper. There's no supply. There's no shortage of toilet paper and. Really anywhere. Like there's a couple brands that aren't showing up right now.
Right.
But that's just more like what warehouse levels were before this shit hit, right? Kind of thing. So that's about it.
I saw a thing from like you know, people like interviewed like a supplier from Georgia Pacific who was talking about like how essentially the issue is that people are now sitting at home. Mm-hmm. And so they're using toilet paper at their regular rate. But they're using like the fancy toilet paper that you buy
yeah. to
get at home instead of like the big industrial rolls that you use at work.
Mm-hmm.
And like that does make a difference. That does, you know, it is like one of those things. So, you know, who knows? There's still toilet paper in the markets, although it's mostly just like, you know, a handful of brands and whatever. But
yeah,
if we could just, if we get the end of this and just kind of go, yeah, it's just all store brands because like nobody really cares otherwise. I'm really okay with that. Like, yeah, let's just destroy the idea that it matters, like what brand of tomato canned tomatoes you buy. Like, yeah, no, there's one brand. It's fine.
Yeah, get down to that point in Repo Man where everything is just generic labels, beer.
It's funny how, like, you know, like in that movie, it is kind of like, oh, this is like a sign of like some version of dystopia. But the idea that there are five brands of tomatoes and they all compete with one another to produce effectively identical products, and suddenly there's like marketing managers who are expected to like try to compete, like that's even worse ultimately.
Yeah, yeah. Like, I mean, you know, they all the different brands, they generally all taste the same. Yeah. You can take them home. And with just a little bit of know-how, you can tweak them to the to what you want. Mm-hmm. And you know, you don't have to rely on brand loyalty. That's just bullshit. So, yeah,
I buy store brand everything except for like a couple of products in which I do like prefer, you know. But anyway, we are far afield from our goal here, right? We
have
a lot to get through. Instead, I'm talking about canned tomatoes. So
we're not trying to solve the world's problems tonight. We're just going to be looking at two movies, and we're in the talkies now.
We're into the sound era,
yeah.
Which is I put these on the list. And I'm like, oh no, we'll do these, and I was kind of like, oh no, these are both still silence, even though they're after 1927, but they're not. And so it was kind of a surprise, kind of a pleasant, kind of a weird surprise. It was like, oh. If I had planned this a little bit better, we would have done these after the big episode 200. But, you know, yeah, it's fine.
That's so. Fine. Yeah, so we're going to be looking at In Old Arizona from 28 and The Virginian from 1929. But before we get into that, we do have some housekeeping to get through. So let's just go right to the YouTube comments because here they are.
Plus, why not? Yeah. Yeah.
Someone on the rundown episode, which seems to get a lot of YouTube comments lately, so this must be maybe someplace in like East Asia finally got YouTube and they're all looking for this movie or some shit. But on the rundown episode, someone called Canyon Ijo wrote Kontol, and I looked this up and I think it was Indonesian for dick. So he's basically calling us a dick.
You know,
yeah, for not giving them the movie, I guess.
Yeah, well, or, you know, just he maybe they listened to the episode and just thought we were dicks about it, which you know, like yeah,
could be
completely
true.
Reasonable perspective, honestly. I don't have a problem with that.
Someone called Daniel Negron on our The Laura Lee's Grasp episode said bitch talking.
Yeah.
Again, very kind of nebulous.
Very difficult to really respond to that intelligently.
I did respond to it. I said, yes, indeed, there was a bitch talking. Congratulations.
Yeah. Oh, well, his name was Daniel Negron.
Concerned. Yeah. Yeah. On our bad
not
day
all
of
Daniels. Black... Not all Daniels. That's the...
No, not all Daniels. Yeah. Not all Daniels. Hashtag not all Daniels. On our Bad Day at Black Rock episode, someone called Albertus said, waste of time.
And I asked that movie is not a waste of time.
No.
I assure you. No, it's not. And there is no other explanation for that response than referring to the movie as a waste of time.
I asked for clarification, but he gave me none.
Yeah, so. Well, I choose to believe that this person is not a fan of the film. Considers the Spencer Tracy classic, A Bad Day at Black Rock, a waste of time, and therefore has no intelligent opinions about cinema that are worth discussing. Really no opinions about anything worth discussing.
No, I mean, he just he couldn't buy Spencer Tracy with one arm beating the shit out of a gang of toughs. So I guess he
clearly, yeah.
His suspension of disbelief was just shattered. Albertus, I'm disappointed in you. Yeah. We have a slightly positive one. Well, that's mostly positive.
I love how we grade on a curve with our comments.
No, this one is mostly positive. On our Sorcerer episode, someone called Brett Owen says, thanks for covering this film and your insights, but please, it's not Schrider. And I probably mispronounced because, you know, I fucking do that all the time when I get drinking, so...
Fair.
Roy Scheider. Yes, I know.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for your comments.
And we got two comments on their Facebook group. They must be destroyed on site on Facebook. You should, you know, join that and find out what's coming up on the podcast if you haven't done so already. And you'll get insightful comments like this from one of our new favorite posters, David Wilt, who says, "This year marks the 20th anniversary of the cheerleading comedy Bring It On," which, yeah.
Yeah. Have you seen Bring It On?
I didn't, because I knew there was going to be no tits in it. So it's like, I don't want to watch a cheerleading movie.
It's actually pretty cute. It's better than you think it is. We'll just leave it at that.
See, I either want to watch, when it comes to like a cheerleading movie, it's either got to be The Cheerleaders,
yep,
which is just straight on like weird art house porn movie, or it's got to be like But I'm a Cheerleader, like that indie film from the, was it the 90s or 2000s?
90s, the Natasha
Lyonne.
Like It Turns Out I'm a Lesbian movie. Which is, we should cover that at some point, maybe. I would cover that with you.
Mm-hmm.
I don't disagree. Bring It On. There's some interesting stuff in it. There's some fun stuff in it. It's not quite your trip level, but it's got some fun stuff. Like, there's some interesting material in it. And, like, it's better than you think it is based on the premise.
I just saw that there's, like, 8,000 sequels to it. And I was like, oh, this can't be good.
I haven't watched any of the sequels because I've chosen to just kind of limit my exposure to that content to the original movie. And kind of, like, I got to the end of the movie and I'm like, that was fine. That's my response to Bring It On. That was fine. I'm actually really happy that it exists. That's fine. And I don't need the sequels because I'm assuming they will make me hate the entire property. So that's kind of where I land on it.
Okay. And here, and I'm sure this is probably in response to the fact that we have failed this man and we are now doing talkies. James Slater Murphy said, "I accept Lee's invitation to fight him anytime, any place." And here's the thing, though. Here's the thing. James posted this on April 1st. I assumed it's an April Fool's joke because he knows I would just take him out.
Clearly.
That's what it is. So, you know, you dodged the bullet there, James. Congratulations. And get on this podcast soon.
Yeah, definitely.
Hey, we're getting into the 30s. We're going to be doing Universal stuff here, you know, in a few weeks. So, yeah, Universal Horror, he wanted on, so we're going to do that.
James Murphy's never invited on any podcast I ever host anymore because he is a wuss who could not defeat you in combat.
I've taken his man
card away from him. That's my opinion. That's my learned opinion on this. No, it's fine.
Right on.
It's
fine. Yeah.
James Murphy is welcome back at any time, of course. Yes.
Yes, open door invitation for James, one James Murphy. And I'll just point out, and this is why you should join the Facebook group, because guys like Robert Ward drop interesting links into the wall every once in a while. He's been doing a bunch of that for our sort of silent movie series. And he dropped two links here. And so if you go to the Facebook group, you'll see them. The first one is a link to a documentary, I guess, A Queer Romance, Gay Characters and Male Bonding in Early Film, Silent Film and Pre-Code, which sort of connects back to some of the stuff we were talking about in Wings, basically. You know, how we were sort of theorizing, yeah, there's a hell of a lot of gay subtext in this film. And I haven't watched that yet. It's only an hour. I'll probably get into that pretty soon, but you can check that out there. And the other thing he dropped was a news story on IndieWire saying dozens of 100-year-old photos from the making of Dr. Caligari go up for auction. And apparently they're just single photos, I guess, are selling upwards for $13,000. And they do give a couple of the photos here. They're in sepia tone, and they're interesting. They definitely look a little different from, the finished version of the film. And it's cool.
Yeah.
Just cool that those photos actually exist. I'm actually kind of amazed.
It's kind of amazing that any documentation from, like, that era still exists, especially for, I guess Caligari is was well renowned early enough to sort of like be something like, oh yeah, people should like archive this, but I've ranted about this many times over the course of the last 200 episodes of you know, so much stuff gets lost because, you know, nobody cares past, you know, 15 minutes after the thing gets released in the theaters.
Right.
For a lot of the stuff we cover. And so it's always nice to get a hint of that. So.
Yeah. And thanks for those links, Robert. We really do appreciate you dropping those interesting little tidbits here and there on the Facebook wall. That's cool shit. So. Yeah. Yeah. It's almost like the DVD extras to our podcast or something like
exactly,
that.
Exactly, exactly. One day, there's going to be a TMBDOS remastered. You know? Like,
well, that's only going to happen if somehow I get super fucking rich, and then I'll pay someone to remaster everything and make us sound like fucking gold. But, yeah.
No, I'm just imagining, like, in the future, we will be rediscovered by history. As you know, the greatest film critics of our generation, despite the fact that we are making a drunken podcast late at night on a Saturday. It's always my Saturday evenings. I live an exciting life, people. Like,
hey, we got one up on Siskel and Ebert, as far as I'm concerned, because we actually like each other, so we're not like those two dicks.
That's fair. I mean, at least we can fake it for the microphone. Actually, yeah, they're mortal enemies. And
yeah, you know. The amount of times I've tried to kill Daniel Harper in the last 5 or 6 years, it's just
yeah.
But since you're still alive, Daniel, we can move on to what we watched lately. I am going to reserve what I've watched lately just for brevity's sake, but I know you've watched something, so go ahead.
Yeah, I watched a really good movie, 36 Chamber of Shaolin, which I had never seen before because I am a loser. It's very good. I'm assuming you know the film fairly well. There was a the RZA did a YouTube video where it was like kind of talking about like the samples that he had used in and Wu-Tang albums from Shaw Brothers films. And like kind of talking about what these songs meant to him. And I kind of saw that. And then I happened to log on to Amazon Prime because I had some time, because we all have time now. Although you and I did not, but you know, like suddenly I was like, I was on Amazon Prime and like 36 Chamber of Shaolin showed up. And it was a movie I'd always wanted to see. And I was like, actually, I will watch this. And, it's very, very good. It's like one of the greatest martial arts movies of all time. It will be on my best of the year list. It's nice. Phenomenal. I would like to discuss it. I would like to discuss more of these films sometime. One day when we get to the 70s, sometime in 2022, we will probably start covering it again. But yeah, no, I feel bad that it took me this long to watch it, but it was really fucking good. It's on Amazon Prime. And it's definitely worth your time if you haven't seen it and you're a fan of this show. I think one of the things that I really love about it is that it's kind of plotless in the sense that it does have a narrative. It does have sort of a, you know, like guy, you know, kind of gets has to go down to the you know, the lower classes, and then he kind of joins the monks and then kind of does the thing. And so there is like kind of this kind of political, socio-political element to it. But ultimately, the movie's like 90 minutes long, and like an hour in the middle is just like training sequences. And these are some of the greatest martial arts sequences like ever put to film. And so there is a kind of like the, you know, spoiler alert, the 36th chamber of Shaolin is essentially there are 35 chambers for the monks, and then the 36th is like, and now we're going to train the working class. And I have feels about that, good feels about that. This is a good thing. This is a good thing in 2020. But it doesn't like shove, you know, it's a perfectly like reasonable thing to just kind of sit and watch and just enjoy on its own kind of like very superficial merits if you just choose to do that. So, yeah, definitely worth watch if you haven't already.
Yeah. Those movies, like the sort of top tier Shaw Brothers stuff, like, you get a lot of those like training sequences, and you get like the title sequences that's like showing all the styles and the weapons that are going to be featured in the movie, you know, basically. And you always see these sort of like cool montages of that stuff, like in the opening credits. It's been a while since I've seen it. I can't remember if 36 Chambers does that or not.
I don't think that one does. I don't remember it. It was more just kind of like it starts off, gets the Shaw scope kind of thing.
Okay.
You know, the beginning of the movie. And like, I feel like always with like movies from the 70s, I kind of like tune out a little bit in the first 90 seconds, in the first like two or three minutes. It's just a thing. I don't know. Maybe it's just kind of engendered to me in this podcast of just kind of like, yeah, anything in the first, like, you know, like 5 minutes is just kind of like meaningless setup that we don't need for an audience in 2020, you know? I feel like that's a fault of mine, but also I'm okay with it. I'm okay with it.
All right. Yeah. Okay. So we're going to take a quick break. We're going to play a little bit of music and some podcast promos, and we're going to come back with In Old Arizona.
You ungodly warlock.
New movie reviews all the time. See if these films age just like a fine wine.
Oh no, we'll jack it up again.
TV, games, and more with them.
Rotten Tomatoes and IMDb are all the rage, but we'll lock those critics up in one cage.
The Jacked Up Review Show, every Wednesday evening on Spotify, Podbean, Anchor, and other available podcast apps.
Hello there. My name is Matt, and I'm a humble court bailiff in a courtroom designed to bring musical justice to all. Each week, we have a podcast with a judge and a jury, and we determine whether a song is guilty, not guilty, or not guilty by reasons of insanity. You know, something like,
sucking, licking, lubing, fisting.
Or maybe it's a cover of Tom Petty. You can find us wherever you find podcasts, iTunes, Google Play, all that stuff. Just look for Songs on Trial, please. Okay, I love you. Make good choices.
You ungodly warlock.
All right, In Old Arizona from 1928, and this is directed by Irving Cummings. Fully admit, because of time restraints, I didn't do as deep a dive on sort of people's backgrounds as I've been doing in these episodes. He did do one of the sequels to this, and we'll get into this, The Cisco Kid. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what I looked at. Like, the rest of it, like, he's got an big fucking filmography. He was also an actor and director, but a lot of the stuff I saw there didn't ring a bell at all. It's like, this is all stuff I've never seen.
Yeah, one of the things that I ran into, because I did like kind of a cursory look at sort of like what some of these people kind of did other than this and both of these films, and you know, which is very different for the other film we're going to cover today than this one.
Yeah.
But there is like a lot of like, you know, this is the transition from silent to talkie. And so there are some people who sort of made that transition and some people who didn't. But for the most part, most people who made the transition still didn't really make a lot of stuff like after like 1940 or, you know, 1950 or so. And so there's this entire like thriving industry that exists in this kind of early era that you and I just have like no kind of like cultural knowledge of, just because like we haven't immersed ourselves into it until now. And so like, I am very tempted to just like go and like add a bunch of these movies at random to the list and just like start like going through them, because I think it's fascinating to kind of look at movies from this era and a little bit later.
There is a shit ton of stuff that came out of this movie.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, this is a character from O. Henry. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, and that's something like I just saw the title. I'll admit, I put the title on the list. I saw it as like kind of like, oh, like kind of early Western, something mm-hmm. we should definitely cover. I saw it as like, oh, okay, it's based. I didn't know it was like based on an O. Henry story. Didn't know like kind of the provenance of it, and so like all the like history that kind of goes into it. But ultimately, you know, this was you know, the lead actor here won Best Actor in the second mm-hmm. ever Oscar ceremony, and so this is kind of a prestige film of the time, and I think that affects the way that I see it, certainly in the sense of, you know, kind of where I land on, you know, kind of its cultural importance in some ways.
Yeah.
But it also implies a certain thing about like what who the actors are in this and what was kind of expected from the audience in terms of viewing it. And I think that yeah, and just kind of thinking in terms of kind of the larger cultural content around its creation, because I think the film itself is fairly slight in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. But there's some kind of interesting stuff kind of going on in terms of its construction. Anyway, sorry, I'm kind of getting into commentary as opposed to, you know, introduction here. But
yeah, go ahead. So we'll just quickly, writers, this course based on the O. Henry story, the Caballero's Way. The writing credits for basically screenplay and stuff are Tom Berry, Paul Gerald Smith. This is starring very small cast, basically. Like, a lot of the people are basically just uncredited.
It's basically mm-hmm. three lead actors and then like a bunch of also-rans.
Yeah, so Edmund Lowe as Sergeant Mickey Dunn. Warner Baxter is probably the standout here is the Cisco Kid, and Dorothy Burgess as Tanya Marie, also a standout, and we'll get into that. But I do want to mention that so basically the Cisco Kid character in the original O. Henry story is much more murderous, but apart from that, this kind of follows the story pretty much to a T for the most part.
Have you read the story? I did not read the story
before. I read it a long time ago.
Okay.
And to be completely honest, I totally pretty much forgotten it, and I sort of picked this up in research that, yes, indeed, it does pretty much follow the story to a T. Okay. Cisco Kid character, he would come back in the film, The Cisco Kid, in 31, and Warner Baxter would reprise his role, as well as Edmund Lowe would reprise his role, too. Then there was The Return of the Cisco Kid, again with Warner Baxter in 39. Then there was The Cisco Kid and the Lady in 39 with Cesar Romero, and he'd actually take over the series, and he would do just a bunch of films with the Cisco Kid character. Baxter was also in a film called The Arizona Kid in 1930, which was The Cisco Kid. It was actually a sequel to this, but they temporarily lost the rights to the characters, so they had to call him The Arizona Kid. Which is great.
Doesn't this feel very like 1960s Italian cinema or something to you?
Kind of. But yeah, so, you know, basically Cesar Romero primarily took over the series for the most part. There was also a TV series. And then in 1994, there was a reprisal, a TV movie with Jimmy Smits as the Cisco Kid and Cheech Marin as his sidekick Poncho. And that was kind of a thing that was introduced, I think, in the movies and in the TV show, which I believe was in the 1950s or somewhere around there. So
I feel like you and I could do a deep dive and just like view these for like a month and just go like, oh my God, what like brilliance and what garbage we can.
Apparently the TV series was hella racist. Let's just put it that way.
Well, we're going to get there. Don't worry.
But we have a synopsis here from Shannon Patrick Sullivan on IMDb. And he says, or she says, Army Sergeant Mickey Dunn sets out in pursuit of the Cisco Kid, a notorious, if kind-hearted and charismatic bandit of the Old West. The kid spends most of his loot on Tanya, the woman he loves, not realizing that she is being unfaithful to him in his absence. Soon, with her oblivious paramour off plying his trade, Tanya falls in with Dunn, drawn by the allure of this substantial reward for the kid's capture, dead or alive. Together, they concoct a plan to ambush and do away with the Cisco Kid once and for all. And yeah, that's pretty much it. It is a love triangle, but it's not.
Yeah, both in these movies are kind of like have a similar kind of thing going on, which I didn't kind of expect. I really was like, oh, two Westerns, 2 years apart, you know, in the late 20s. Let's just do them together. But there is a very clear similarity, and to another film which we've already covered, which is one of our great episodes, which
we will get to.
Yeah, I loved it. I love that you and I just work on similar lines at this point. Yeah, no.
So what are your sort of general thoughts on this one?
God, there's so much. This is a movie that it's weird, like coming out of like all these like silence, and then suddenly we're like, oh, talkies. You know, the moment has passed. We are now into talkies, and you know, to kind of be seeing like something that looks a lot more like a regular movie again, and that it's amazing to what degree like you're basically going to start seeing like up until like the late 50s, this is just kind of what Westerns looked like. Like you could, like this is from 1928, and there are some certain stylistic factors that we could kind of like point to, and I'm going to do that here in a second, but like ultimately, Westerns are just going to look like this for 40 years, basically. That said, the performances are very stylized in that kind of silent movie way. They're very performative. They're very, kind of mannered in that sense of like, you know, you kind of get to the cheap seats. You kind of get to like it's a mix of this kind of very kind of stage acty sort of elocution in combination with this highly performative, like almost pantomime kind of performance level. I'd actually really love to get, I don't know if Elliot Chapman is still watching and still listening to this podcast, but I'd love to get his thoughts on like what the performances look like here, because it was kind of fascinating to me to kind of see. At a certain point, I literally like turned the sound off just to sort of get the sense of it. And despite the fact that there's a lot of dialogue in this, this would work as a silent film. You could kind of like put little bits of dialogue here and there, a few title cards, and just kind of like sell it as a silent film. Visually, it works as a silent film, and it works as a very good silent film. Ultimately, I think like as a talkie, it feels like this kind of like weird hybrid where it's both trying to kind of be this kind of more emotionally complex. It's trying to be something that's a little bit more psychologically interesting, but ultimately there's just not a lot of meat there. And so it just sort of like, it feels very long. It feels like it's like, we're filling 90 minutes with this kind of ultimately bare bones story that we could have done in 60 minutes, except, you know, we need to fill the time. And suddenly we have the sort of the added pressures of like having to like talk into microphones. It's technically top notch in the sense of like, this was apparently the first outdoor sound recording on a large scale for a film. And honestly, there are no like from the version that I watched, there were no like issues that I kind of ran into. I was expecting to kind of get like, you know, a little bit of like, ooh, where people are kind of in and out of the microphone the way that you and I run into because we're fucking amateurs. But you know, you don't run into that here. It sounds great. It's perfect. You know, that said, you know, I feel like the story is interesting. Well, I don't know. We could get into the story here in a minute, maybe. There is also like the fact that, you know, two of our three. Well, okay, let's. Let's table that for a second and kind of get your general thoughts before you get to the characters, because I have lots of thoughts about the characters. Like, I feel like we could have done this one by itself, and like I almost wish we had, because I have so many thoughts on this. But this might be a 3-hour episode. We'll see. So I'm gonna just hand it over to you. General thoughts about the film.
I liked, I was sort of in the mindset of silent films now, where we've been doing so many, even though, you know, on the side I'm watching,
yeah,
I'm like, sure, modern films and stuff, but still, when, you know, I get into TMBDOS mode, then I'm in it, and like you, I was actually surprised. I didn't realize these were talkies. I thought, oh, Daniel picked two more silent films for us before, you know. For then,
that was my fuck up. I'll admit that. Yeah.
No, but it was fine. It was a nice little slap in the face. It's like I get into it, and I think the opening atmosphere of it is really good. I liked the opening scene where you see the sort of little comedy bit with the characters going in the stagecoach, and you get some nice camera work where it's like, yeah, this is a modern film with some good camera techniques going on. And it's showing a bunch of people doing stuff, and it all looks good. You get the mariachi band playing, which diegetically becomes part of the score. And then it surprised me, because I looked on IMDb and it was like action adventure. It's like, no,
this is a comedy movie. Yeah, no, it's very well. Like, the best stuff in this is comedy.
Ultimately. Well, like 90% of it is a comedy hangout movie, basically, because it's a lot of characters just sitting around talking more than anything else. Like, there's literally maybe a minute of action in this film.
Yeah, ditto for the other film we're gonna do, where, you know, like, you know, I think there are like 4 gunshots that make the climactic gun battle.
Yeah,
it's like, yeah, I know. Yeah, it's fine.
Yeah. But. Yeah, I liked it, but we'll probably get into that as well. But there was a tonal shift in this where I was like, kind of took me out of it a little. I was not ready for this comedy to turn into like a dark, like judgment on a character and it to get to that degree of seriousness. I was like, I was kind of shocked by it.
Yeah, no, I. So let's talk about the characters, our three leads. And I'm going to start with who is ultimately the least important and least racist of the three. And that's Emin Lowe as Mickey Dunn.
Oh, you mean John Wayne before John Wayne?
Which is exactly the point I was going to make, which is we've already done Stagecoach. And I really do just want to, you know, just tell people, just watch Stagecoach from 1939. Which is 11 years after this. And John Wayne, like, it is weird that you see this character, and it's clear that, like, filmmakers are looking for that John Wayne archetype. And the, like, John Wayne just, like, waltzes into that in 1939 in John Ford's Stagecoach. And it makes, like, both their careers, ultimately. But it's very clear that he's, like, trying to do that same thing. But, like, you know, it's clear that there was a gap in terms of like what these films needed that John Wayne filled. And that's ultimately kind of the thing that made John Wayne, John Wayne. As much as John Wayne was just like really talented, and, you know, for all of the issues that you and I could have with him, he filled a niche, but it wasn't like he showed up and suddenly he transformed the thing. It was like he showed up and fulfilled the thing that was already missing. Yeah. And so you kind of look at, like, Emin Lowe. He's not bad at this, but he's not John Wayne. And he's very clearly, from modern eyes, doing a sub-rate John Wayne. So
buffoonish John Wayne is basically what he is.
Yeah, no, very, very clearly. The other two characters that we kind of care about in this, Warner Baxter as the Cisco Kid, again, the second ever winner of Best Actor at the Oscars, and Dorothy Burgess as Tonya Maria, who I kind of love honestly. These are both like brown face racist caricatures. It is like we've talked a lot about like racism in these films that we're kind of covering, and we've talked a lot about like kind of how just the sort of like fundamentally racist ideology like covers all of these. It feels weird to suddenly be in the talkie era and to kind of talk about like, oh, this is the second film. This is the, you know, 1928, the second year after talkies existed, and suddenly being like, and they're literally doing like Mexican patois, you know, sort of like this like incredibly racist Mexican accent. And then like this wins the Best Actor Oscar for, and he's literally going like, hey, senor, you know, like it's almost Speedy Gonzalez level.
Well, I mean, it's weird. Baxter's not even doing that. Like he sounds like Bela Lugosi. Like,
sure.
I was listening to this. I was like, is that supposed to be a Mexican accent? Like,
right. Well, I don't know. So it's funny also, and this is something that you kind of get into, is the woman who plays the cook, who's the older woman who lives with Tony Maria, is actually Hispanic, like a native Spanish speaker. And she sounds like a native Spanish speaker. And then suddenly you get like Dorothy Burgess kind of coming in and like kind of doing the like, oh, hello, we get the, you know, and it's like, I don't
it's
know.
Very
I,
over you know, the
it's,
top.
Yeah, it's very over the top. That said, I do kind of admire the everybody just wants to fuck element of this episode. Like, yeah. This is the most horny on main movie we've covered in a long time. Of like, literally everybody is like, you know, well, I've got a betrothed. I've got somebody that I'm, you know, one to be with. But also, like, my private parts want things, and we're just going to do that instead. And I kind of appreciated that about the film. It's hugely, like, there's so much going on in this.
It's a lot of innuendo in this. And just,
there's,
you know,
there's a moment in this where I thought that, like, Warner Baxter was, like, finger fucking Dorothy Burgess on screen.
Oh, when she was up in the like the loft or whatever.
Yes, exactly. Like there's a moment where she's like halfway down the ladder and he's like kind of like grasping her in his arms and his hand is like right in that spot or her thigh.
Yeah.
And I'm just kind of like, are you literally finger fucking her in front of her like elderly roommate? It was actually only like 43 or whatever, if you look at the actress. But anyway, yeah, it's like, this is fine. The old woman is making you ham and eggs, and you're figure fucking girlfriend, and you sent her out because like you're just charming as fuck doing your.
Well, I mean, it's kind of a I mean, it kind of explains why they sort of ignore the ham and eggs and they start to burn on the stove.
Yeah, because, clearly. But they can't, like, display any of that, you know? It's just like, oh, they're, like, kisses. And that's the thing that you kind of run into is, like, there is this is pre-code, right? Mm-hmm. And so, like, there is this, like, five-year period, and we'll get to this as we kind of talk more about films of this era, where you could kind of do like kind of naughty, sexy things. And there's a lot of that kind of going on in this film. And like from a modern perspective, it feels very tame, but at the time it was very, you know, like, oh, this is like pretty aggressively like cool stuff. But also like it's framed within this, like, you know, and then I'm going to display my love by doing the very, you know, performative silent movie. Like, I'm going to grab you by the shoulders and kiss you and then push you away. And that's like the, you know, the very, like, the cinematic traditions have changed so much in sort of the tropes and the way that we sort of express these things visually. It's just such a weird viewing experience, ultimately.
How about... So, okay, just more on this sort of note of, like, innuendo and stuff. How about that great scene where Cisco Kid, you know, he just robbed the stagecoach, so now he's got a bunch of gold, he's getting shaved, he's getting pampered and everything, getting a bath and all that stuff, and then Dunn comes in, Dunn doesn't know who the Cisco Kid is, no one knows what Cisco Kid looks like, so they become, like, fast friends in the barbershop.
Sure.
And they start comparing gun sizes. The dude comes down and just taps the dude's gun. Oh, nice gun you got there. And then the other guy goes, oh, nice gun you got there, pretty big. Like, they're basically tapping each other's dicks right at that point.
There's a very there's definitely kind of a homosexual subtext to a little bit of that, you know, which is great. You know, also one of the things I actually do love about this film is the level, like the humor. I actually found it really funny.
I did too. I laughed quite a few times.
Yeah. Not something I was expecting kind of going into this, but like, it really does kind of, if you kind of abstract away all the other stuff that's in the movie and just kind of look at like certain sequences as like, oh, these are just kind of comedy bits. It's very easy to laugh at. It's very easy to kind of accept it as like even kind of a modern, you know, comedy.
It helps make the sort of big stylized silent era performances work better in that context too. So I found.
Yeah, it works better as comedy than drama, I think. And yeah. I think we do have to get into like kind of where this film goes, because like one of the things that we haven't really talked about, we've talked about all the, you know, the kind of the general archetypes of the characters, but like this film ultimately gets to, so there's a love triangle. Poor Dorothy Burgess is like kind of asked to do the real lion's share of the work here of like selling both the kind of like love for both of these men, but also, you know, kind of turning on a dime and kind of like, you know, it's an unbelievable performance, but it's an unbelievable performance because she's asked to do something that's impossible, ultimately.
Yeah.
The writing of this is, like, completely absurd. I don't buy her at any moment except that, like, she's horny. which honestly would be a better version of this than, like, you know, I actually think you're going to take me to New York and we're going to do the Bowery Square or whatever, you know.
Sort of, yeah, Dunn wants to take her to New York and Cisco wants to take her to Portugal.
Right, yeah. Right. You know, oh, you're gonna kill my other boyfriend and make $5,000 and give it to me, and therefore I will be with you. And it's there's a part of me that wants to kind of give it, you know, to kind of give it a pass because it's 1929 and maybe there's a kind of cultural expectation that just doesn't play 100 years later or 90 years later. But also, like, yeah, this is kind of fucked up, you know. And, you know, regardless, I think she does a perfectly good. I think Burgess does a perfectly good job of like kind of selling it in the moment. It just kind of doesn't make sense again from a modern perspective and kind of thinking of it as a, you know, kind of a character. Like, it's hard for me to kind of put together a narrative of who this character is supposed to be. And I think that that's ultimately a problem of, apparently in the original Henry story, the Cisco Kid is like an explicit villain.
Yeah, no, he's evil as shit. Like, he sets her up to get killed.
Right, and here he's kind of supposed to be kind of a hero, and I don't know, there's so much like about the Mexican border and stuff
that
we get into. If we wanted to kind of get into that, maybe we'll do it in the next, I don't know, it's fine. But I did find a complexity in terms of like her performance and what she's asked to do and what the script is going to give her versus, you know, I do wish there was like a little bit more leeway. There was a little bit more, you know, kind of context to this. And ultimately this whole, like, one of the things that we kind of get in both of these films is the woman who is the love interest of the villain and the hero. And, you know, that does play into High Noon, which I think is the movie that you and I both were thinking heavily of in this episode. Particularly, I think maybe we'll get into that in the next movie. We'll talk a little bit more about that. But what I run into is the fact that we kind of run into this character, we kind of run into this trope, but she's just kind of asked to perform it. You know, she's not really given any time to justify it. She just has to perform it. And I don't know, that's difficult.
Yeah, no, she's given a thankless role, really, because there's no real, there's nothing really around her to justify her being the way she's presented in the film. I mean, she performs the role perfectly well with whatever she's given, but she's asked to wear the black hat when it doesn't make sense. And
but I like her. She's my favorite character ultimately. Mm-hmm. Like I think, like, yeah, go get yours. Yeah, fuck around. You're good. I don't know. I like slutty girls, and that's not a judgment call. It's just like, yeah, she likes to get laid. They're couple of like cute guys coming after her. What I don't like is the sort of manipulative thing. And then like ultimately the movie ends with her like, so I mean, you know, spoiler alert for the movie. So like there's the whole thing is like this battle between our two male leads and it's kind of like a manipulative thing. And then like ultimately the good guy falls in love with the girl. And he is going to marry her. He's going to kind of take her away, but he's got to kind of kill the bad guy first to get the money. They kind of make that happen. And then the bad guy kind of finds out about this because he's like lurking over the corner, like Nancy Drew style.
Yeah.
And then he kind of manipulates the situation until, no, I'm going to escape wearing the woman's clothes and she's going to escape wearing my clothes. And then like feeds that into like the network of information going to the good guy and the quote unquote good guy, I should say. Mm-hmm. And then like the movie ends with the good guy, you know, the U.S. Marshal, the Texas Ranger, whatever he's supposed to be, shows up and just like shoots the person wearing female clothes and from the distance with in cold blood. And therefore he kills his fiance and the Cisco Kid gets away, which is like real serial killer shit where the Cisco Kid has just kind of like set this up and he's supposed to be like, you know, oh yeah, this is not the dark and stormy version. This is the like, you know, which the film ultimately ends on like, well, she was bad because she was a slut. Like that's kind of where the film ends.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. All this. And it is this kind of very O. Henry kind of thing where, you know, two people want something and they're both trying to kind of like give something to the person they love, but because of a misunderstanding, everything ends up bad. Right.
Yeah.
And I totally get that. Except like, you know, there is a sense in which, you know, Tony and Maria really did nothing wrong here. Except like take the best option. You know, and like I don't know. It's a very frustrating kind of film on that level.
Yeah, yeah. And Cisco Kid is like, in the end, he comes off like Thomas Ripley or something like that, where he's manipulated everybody into doing all this dirty work for him,
and then he just runs away. And it's like, and yeah, well, yeah. You know what, and then the movie ends. It's
over. You know what makes it worse? The direct sequel to this, where both characters come back, the two main male leads come back. Apparently, our cowboy there doesn't give a shit. Apparently, they just sort of dropped the whole, oh yeah, you killed my girlfriend in the last one. It's just like he lets the Cisco Kid get away at the end of the follow up to this. Apparently, so. Right.
But of course, they also like kind of, you know, part of the thing is like, I met you 20 minutes ago and I want you to be the mother of my children.
Right.
Because you are the hottest woman in town and et cetera, et cetera. And,
well, everyone was dying at 35 then, Daniel. They had to get this stuff, you know?
You know, like I get that. Yeah. No, it's
fine. It's fine. They had to kick this in the gear. Let's get married because we ain't going to be living long. Tuberculosis is right around the corner. Come on.
Yeah.
Actually, I think one of the actresses in this died of tuberculosis, if I'm not mistaken. I think actually it was Dorothy Burgess. I think she died of tuberculosis in the 50s, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah,
maybe I don't know. I'm not gonna look it up. That's fine.
Yeah, that sucks.
It is funny how many of these people like died early.
Yeah,
kind of looking at the death dates and like almost nobody lives till like the 80s or whatever. You know.
Right. Yeah. The only other two things is. Two things I found funny. There's just like a throwaway line where two characters are talking and someone says here in the paper, John L. Sullivan going to quit drinking. And then the other guy goes, I don't believe that. I'm just thinking fake news. That's that conversation right there. And then the stagecoach driver who is, you know, held up by the Cisco Kid.
Which is one of the most fun sequences in the film is the stagecoach robbery where like the Cisco Kid, he steals the gold from the bank. And then like there's a pretty girl who, you know, kind of comes, you know, she's like, oh, you got like a private effect, and she's got like this like kind of effect or whatever. I can't remember exactly what it was, but it's like, no, I don't steal from individuals. And this is supposed to like kind of demonstrate his goodness as a character, you know. sort of.
Yeah, he's kind of, well, he does the Robin Hood kind of thing.
It's a cool scene. It doesn't really fit into the movie.
I guess it's just there to make the Cisco Kid look better, because he takes like a brooch from this woman, but he pays her gold in return to compensate, right? And but yeah, anyway, the stagecoach driver, I just like, because there's like three or four scenes in the opening, like 10-15 minutes or whatever, where everyone he sees, he's like, I'd have shot him myself if I hadn't been, you know, had to throw my gun down. He finally tells it to like the head of the fucking Ford or whatever that he's complaining to, and the guy's like, yeah, get the fuck out of here, like, just you weren't gonna do shit, buddy. Like,
this, yeah, no, that character is really fun, where he's kind of like, you know, oh, no, I would have totally been the badass, except like I just didn't have my gun on me, and it's like, yeah, fuck you.
Yeah.
But yeah, this is your justification, it's fine. But you know,
box offices for this was 1.3 million, and I don't believe that's adjusted at all. So I did not have a budget on it, but I mean, that's got to be good.
Yeah, it's got to be good. Yeah,
yeah. And I imagine, you know, this being like one of the first talkies, it was kind of a sensation on its own.
And like, it is funny that like at this point, we have audio recorded out of a studio. Was the effect? It was effectively like Avatar or whatever, you know, like in terms of level of technology. And it is, you know, it is seamless. Like this doesn't sound bad. And admittedly, the version that I watched was the I rented the version on YouTube. So
same here.
There may be some, you know, remastering, some kind of stuff kind of going on there. Maybe if we kind of had an original print from 1928, we could kind of like recognize some difficulties. But the version I watched sounded great. I had no issues with it. Yeah.
The only flaws I saw in the entire movie really were there's some hard cuts that don't match up too well.
Yeah.
But that's just kind of from the time. That's just kind of what happened.
Well, you'll see that. I mean, movies today kind of run into that issue. You know?
Yeah. Only big trivia piece I have here that we haven't sort of gone through is Raoul Walsh was cast as the Cisco Kid, as well being the director for this. But during a return drive to Los Angeles from Utah, a jackrabbit jumped through the windshield of Walsh's car, with both the rabbit and the broken glass hitting Walsh in the face. So it was like a Fabio incident with that fucking duck on the fucking amusement ride, right? This was before safety glass, which came the following year in cars. Damage to Walsh's right eye necessitated replacing him in the lead role, rewriting the script, and reshooting some scenes with a different director while Walsh recuperated. Apparently Walsh is still in the film in some, like, faraway shots.
Yeah, I was kind of reading, like, apparently they reused some of that footage, but it's like the faraway stuff where you can't really see anything, so, you know.
I mean, I don't know if I gave my sort of final thought on this. I think it's worth watching. I think it's got some problems, but it's pretty damn good all the same. I think
it was worth the $4 rental. Like, I would definitely recommend that to people. I think it's worthwhile. Particularly if you're kind of following along this journey with us, as I would hope that some of our listeners are actually kind of like following along with this and kind of going, I'd check that out. I think this is worth a watch. I think there's a lot of really great stuff in it. It's funnier than I think Lee and I have given it credit for. There's a lot of really nice like comedy bits in this.
Comedy. It actually shocked me because, again, like I thought action adventure is what IMDb said. And my cursory glance.
Both this and the other one we're going to do are basically just romance movies.
Like, yeah,
that's you know, which is it's fine. I'm fine with kind of doing some romantic comedies, but this really fits that bill. And honestly, like I could see it as a bit of a date movie, is to kind of like sit down. Except like then you get to the end of this, like the horny girl dies.
You might want to remake it and change it so she doesn't die and maybe not have two of the leads in brown face.
I mean, if you have a partner who is okay with 1920s racism and okay with the woman being punished for wanting to have sex, then this could be kind of a date movie for you, I guess is kind of where I'm going. Like, for a movie from 1928, you know, we're going to create a curve here.
Yeah, I guess so, yeah.
It's funny. It's cute and funny in the parts where it's cute and funny. That's where I land on it. Yeah.
Right, right. All right, so we're going to take a quick break, play a little bit of music, and we're going to come back with The Virginian.
A sweet tuxedo girl, you see, queen of swell society, fond of fun as fond can be, when it's on the strict QT. I'm not too young, I'm not too old, not too timid, not too bold, just the kind you'd like to hold, just the kind for sport, I'm told. Tarara boom die, 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 tarara boom die. I'm queen of London, queen of France, always out for big romance. Old men like to see me dance, if they're nice they have a chance. Of course a gent that's on a spree wants me to sit upon his knee. I tell him, Dad, now don't be free, all I want is jollity. Ta-ra-ra, boom-dee, ta-ra-ra, boom-dee, ta-ra-ra, boom-dee, ta-ra-ra, boom-dee, ta-ra-ra. I'm a blushing bud of innocence, Papa says at big expense. Old maids say I have no sense, boys think that I'm just immense. Before my song I do conclude, I want it strictly understood, the fond of fun, I'm never rude, though not too bad, I'm not too good. Ta-ra-ra, boom-dee, 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 ta-ra-ra, boom-dee.
The Virginian from 1929. This is directed by Victor Fleming, who is also known for quite a few things. Treasure Island from 1934, Captains Courageous from 37, The Wizard of Oz, you might have heard of that, and Gone with the Wind.
Wizard of what? No, I haven't.
The Wizard of Oz.
Gone with the what? No, sorry, drawing a blank.
Written by Owen Wister, who did the story, Kirk Lachelle, Grover Jones, Keen Thompson, Howard Easterbrook, Edward E. Paramore Jr., and Joseph L. Mankiewicz. This is starring Gary Cooper as the Virginian, Walter Houston as Trampas, Mary Bryan as Molly Starkwood, Richard Arlen as Steve, Helen Ware as Mrs. Taylor, Chester Conklin as Uncle Huey, Eugene Paulette as Honey Wiggin, Victor Potel as Nebraska, E.H. Culvert as Judge Henry. Nebraska!
One day I just want to be like nicknamed Michigani. You know,
Michigan and Dan.
Michigan and Dan.
Walking into the
You can't say Michigan-y Dan without also spitting into a spittoon. Like that's how, you know, that goes. Yeah.
I mean that might be, you know, if the world collapses, we'll go back to the local watering hole where it's just, you know, like a shitty bar with like swinging doors and oh look at there. Michigan and Dan coming on in this place again. Never thought I'd see your like in here again, boy. You tenderfoot. Then you shoot the guy dead.
That's exactly how that's going to go. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes.
No. So we have a synopsis here from John Oswalt. He says, Molly Wood arrives in a small western town to be the new schoolmarm. The Virginian, foreman on a local ranch, and Steve, his best friends, who become rivals for her affection. Steve falls in with bad guys led by Trampas, and the Virginian catches him cattle rustling. As foreman, he must give the order to hang his friend. Trampas gets away, but returns in time for the obligatory climatic shootout in the streets. And yeah, that is the movie.
That's, yeah, yeah,
No. That is High Noon the prequel. That's what that is.
It's very High Noon the prequel. I mean, it is like one of those things to where, and I'm just going to recommend anyone listen to this, just kind of pause right now and go listen to our High Noon episode where, and watch High Noon, because that's a film that frames this sort of like what within the internal context of the film feels like very much a lover's squabble in the sense within the framework of, but he's the bad guy and I have to like stand up to him and like defend the town, despite the fact that like, there's no indication that this person will do anything. It's so long as like the white guy who like, you know, stole his girlfriend away is not around, you know, ultimately. Yeah. And although Katie Hirado, who plays Helen in that film, worth fighting for. Just gonna go there. and so Lee and I, when we covered that film, definitely kind of landed on the, you know, no, this is a lover squabble, and this is something that like actually I'd kind of be on the side of the townspeople in this.
Gary Cooper's the asshole who.
It's kind of that story. It's kind of telling that same narrative, and in a very similar way of the last film. Kind of tells the story of, you know, this is ultimately, you know, kind of a battle of wills between, you know, kind of a good guy and a bad guy who are both kind of fighting for the affections of this one woman. But this one is even more overt. I mean, this is very much the prequel to High Noon. So yeah. I would love to see a double feature of these at some point.
That'd be great.
That said, I actually... another thing, this may be in your kind of, trivia bits, but within certain circles, the Virginian, the novel, is considered the first quote-unquote Western outside of the kind of dime store things, although this gets, there are some arguments back and forth within academia in terms of, like, what's really kind of the first quote-unquote Western. And the novel was written in 1904, the film is from 1929, and
there's two previous adaptations of this from 14 and 23,
which, you know, I don't know, it's funny, like, I, you know, they go, oh yeah, these is, you know, this was the thing that was made, and then you go look into it and go, oh yeah, it doesn't exist anymore, or there's a decaying print in the vaults of a movie studio that will never put the money into putting it out there in a way that you and I can watch it, and like this, fuck those companies.
Yeah. Also, apparently, and here's something I was just sort of reading. So this was also remade in 46 and 2000 as a TV movie. Apparently the 46 version, which was much more well-known and popular for quite a while, because apparently the prints of this version were so incredibly shitty until like the 1990s when it got restored.
Yeah, I watched the version on YouTube, which was still pretty bad.
Honestly. It was pretty bad, yeah.
It was pretty bad. I would love to see a cleaned up version of this. I did like the film, ultimately. Like, I did find this like a really entertaining kind of 90-minute watch. That said, you know, it is interesting to see like kind of the High Noon formula, but like with a more like, yeah, this is kind of all about my dick. You know, it's nice to see that. You got Walter Houston, you got Gary Cooper, baby faces at this. Like, I would be hard pressed just kind of looking at this like without kind of knowing that's who they are and like recognizing them, because
same thing with you, exactly the same thing with Wings.
Yeah.
Gary Cooper, and Walter Houston, even like Walter Houston way thinner, way younger than
Treasure of the Sierra Madre, which
so Sierra Madre,
we'll
yeah.
This. I think we'll do that. Yeah.
Oh yeah, we should do that. No.
Yeah, definitely. No. I can't believe we're almost 200 episodes and we haven't done Treasure of the Sierra Madre. Also, in old Arizona, if you want to know what the experience of watching that is, it's just imagine the stinking badges scene, but spread out over 90 minutes. That's the.
I like this quite a bit. I think it works better than the Virginian, because
in old Arizona.
In old Arizona, because here, even though it does take a dark turn, it's not overt comedy for the first half of the film, so it's like, you know, it's an easier kind of ease into that.
Well, it actually interrogates the issues, because ultimately it does have this kind of, like, there's a moment, so our lead,
the Virginian,
he like kind of becomes buddy-buddy with this guy, and they pull pranks together, which like seem really asshole-ish, like juvenile pranks of like
they, you know, switch babies,
around, and so like there are babies that get like christening that weren't supposed to get christening, and
Well, I mean, you know, we're both atheists. That's kind of like, who gives a shit?
I mean, really, it doesn't matter to us, but it definitely mattered to people then. I'm just kind of imagining, like, and then we circumcised your son, like, because we couldn't, this is really fucked up kind of shit. And they're like, I just kind of imagine like the 80s, like sex comedy, like pranks of like, you know, we went on the panty raid, we switched the babies, you know, like sort of thing, you know.
Like a modern Judd Apatow comedy. Yeah. It would be, oh, we switched the babies around and now these babies are getting their foreskins cut off.
and now this baby gets to go to heaven despite the fact that they're Jewish. That's the, you know, that's the lesson. As if there are any Jewish people in this movie. Anyway, so
we say silly things on this podcast.
We once say silly things, and I amused myself. I apologize. Then it gets into, you know, one of the buddies ends up kind of like falling in with this crowd doing cattle rustling, and there's some action sequences, and then he gets caught, and then they end up hanging him in a pretty hardcore sequence.
God damn, that's a
yeah.
That might be one of my favorite sequences in film I've ever seen, honestly. Oh,
yeah. No, I mean, it's an amazing sequence. I mean, if you just imagine, like, we got halfway through Euro Trip, and suddenly, you know,
it turned into Hostel.
It suddenly turned into Hostel. Yeah, no, that's kind of what it ends up being. And they don't tell the girl, our kind of lead woman, who is very good in this. I always try to like Mary Bryan as Molly Stark.
Yeah, you know what? I didn't look her up. You know who I looked up out of the female cast in this?
I know exactly who you looked up in
the
female
cast in this. The barmaid.
The barmaid who...
Nina Quartero.
We definitely are going to have to do some films with her. Not to say we are not going to do some films with Mary Bryan, but the barmaid was clearly the hot one.
I'll just say, like, apparently she did mostly bit parts, but she is, she does have a starring role in The Monkey's Paw from 1934.
Well, throw that into our 1934 bracket and we'll do it. Yeah. It is sort of like it gets to this kind of dark place where suddenly we're kind of examining this, and they actually have a really kind of interesting, for a movie at all, but certainly a movie from 1929, kind of conversation about, like, you know, he hung his friend. He like killed his friend because he broke the law, and that's like an awful thing. And like, no, he should really, like, back in the East where she's from, we have cops and we have a system that does this for us. And ultimately it's like, you know, and so, yes, you've, like, built a system that means that you don't have to confront the brutality of the system under which we live, that will, like, hang the thieves for you so that you don't have to do it yourself. And there is this kind of tension that's kind of going out. And it's interesting that, like, even in 1929, they're sort of looking back to, like, the 1870s or 80s. They make a reference to the Statue of Liberty, but in kind of this kind of general way. There was this kind of long period in which the Statue of Liberty was being built and constructed, and so it could be anywhere between like 1875 and 1886 ultimately. I don't think there's a kind of specific time frame that the film is supposed to be set, and he's supposedly supposed to be kind of an ex-Confederate, and so probably like you know, 1870s.
It feels like death of the old West era, yeah. Because, you know, the town, just the way it's presented, feels mostly, yeah, there's law here. There's, you know, there's ranchers and stuff like that. Like, things seem much more organized than they would have been in, like, just right after the Civil War or before the Civil War kind of era. So,
well, it's interesting that, like, I mean, we talked a bit about High Noon, and we talked a bit about, you know, but this whole idea of, you know, the girl who is kind of caught between hero and villain. I mean, that's something we saw even in, like, revisionist Westerns. I mean, Once Upon a Time in the West, too, which is, you know, one of my personal all-time favorite movies, and yeah, I think one of yours as well. Does this trope to a T in the sense of, like, really observing the brutality behind it. It is interesting to kind of see it this early in cinema. In both of these films, it was kind of like really uncomfortable almost to kind of see the way that the woman is kind of used as, like, the sort of the object of these characters. And I think here in The Virginian, she gets a lot more choice. Like, you know, one of the things that you kind of run into in old Arizona is that she is really inconsistent because nobody really cared about her character. And ultimately they only cared about the dudes. And here she does kind of become the lead. She is the person kind of making decisions for a while. And I think that's interesting.
Yeah. And you could probably almost trace back the trope of the sort of school teacher taming the rough around the edges cowboy, maybe to this film. It might be where it started. And I mean, the most iconic version of that is, well, no, it's not the most iconic version. I'd say, you know, High Noon is the aftermath of that, right?
Absolutely. It is interesting that we did High Noon. Like, High Noon kind of gets to be kind of, certainly from a modern perspective, it gets to be kind of like the art sample. And yet High Noon is, like, responding clearly to stuff that happened 30 years earlier. Or at least 20 years earlier.
But just going back to that hanging scene, I gotta, like, just mention, like, I think some of the finest piece of, like, sort of cinematic storytelling I've seen is in that, where, so the two friends, they have this little thing where they do this sort of, like, quail whistle to each other, I guess. Like, that's kind of their old time thing where they whistle to each other and with bird calls, and then that's how they,
They signal to each other, right? Yeah.
Yeah. So the hanging's going on, and there happens to be a couple, like, quail or whatever around while the hanging's going on, and the Virginian hears it just before Steve gets hanged. He does, I believe he does the call, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, he does the call, like, I think it's before the noose is around his neck.
Yeah.
Like, sort of, like, as he's kind of walking up to the gallows.
And then, after the hanging, and you don't see the hanging, you see the before, and the aftermath is all on the characters who witnessed it. And so Gary Cooper is sort of, you know, he's going away. He gets past the gun belt and gun of Steve, who basically just bequeathed it to him. And there's a note in it, you know, saying, like, I didn't say anything to you, because if I did, I'd start crying like a fucking baby.
Yeah.
You know, like, the friendship's that deep. And then he hears the fucking birds again. And it's like he's hearing his dead friend saying goodbye. And it's like, holy shit, that's the complexity. It's good
filmmaking.
It's just fucking great.
And not to, it's a weird thing to say, we're 2 years into sound
as a
thing that's in movies, right? You know? And so to use, like, that very specific audio cue, and to expect an audience to sort of follow along with that, like, that's really sophisticated, and it works even in 2020. It works completely.
I mean, I'll just say it, like, outright, that honestly, just that alone being sort of implemented into this kind of puts it on my best of list for this year. Like, right there.
I don't know that it's on my list, but I get where you're.
I mean, and I actually like this movie overall enough that it's on my best of list anyway. But I mean, that was like, holy shit! Like, I did not expect to see that. As much as I didn't expect to see a comedy in the first film, I did not expect to see that level of complexity here. And I was like, holy shit! Somebody you need a fucking Oscar, dude. Like,
yeah, no. I mean, I don't. You know, despite the fact that I don't know that this film ends up on my best of list, I think that sequence is. Like, I agree with you. It is one of the great sequences that we've seen in a movie that we've done in this podcast series, and in this podcast in general. I think it's one of the great film sequences, and I think that like it is one of those things that I kind of run into of. In terms of talking about this stuff, and I feel I have complicated feels about this because, like, I don't want to like kind of put myself as someone who's like an expert on this because clearly I'm not.
Mm-hmm.
But I do feel like a lot of like people kind of talking about cinema and kind of talking about like kind of like how movies work, kind of start about 1941, kind of like Citizen Kane is sort of like, oh, this is sort of the beginning of movies.
This is when movies were real.
Right. And that's not true at all. And I feel like maybe, I don't know, like I didn't go to film school and maybe Cameron Sullivan can correct us on this. But,
yeah,
you know, I feel like there's a lot of even today where it's like, yeah, we kind of start in 1970 even, you know. And I feel like part of what we learn kind of going back to these things and kind of examining them, even in the, you know, kind of drunken podcast blasé kind of like, you know, sense that you and I are doing it and not in like in that kind of an academic sense, is to kind of see like, I don't know, there's a great context to all of this that has been lost. And I feel like, I don't know, I get really, I kind of get angry about that we don't have this kind of context in terms of our kind of cultural conversation around this, that we seem really willing to just kind of pretend that, you know, movies just didn't exist before a certain time. And we seem to just kind of like heap praise upon a particular thing because it does it well without sort of like having the kind of the precursor knowledge. And
That's what I like about doing these. It's kind of several times it sort of humbled me on, like, what I thought I knew about films, you know, because, you know, I just haven't seen, before we started doing this, I hadn't seen a lot of stuff from like the first, you know, 50 years of the 1900s.
Yeah, sure.
And
I mean, and that's not like, we shouldn't take that as like a personal affront, right? We shouldn't take that as like, you're a bad person because you haven't seen In Old Arizona, right? Because
no.
Like, and I don't mean this between you and me, it's just like nobody's seen everything, but there is this sort of like panel of experts who get considered to be kind of the people who get to kind of set the agenda in terms of what films get viewed as worthy of consideration in terms of our examination of film history.
Yeah.
And they almost never really think seriously about the silent era unless they're specifically interested in the silent era. And I think even our cursory, like, we've literally just kind of looked at like the top, you know, the ones that like, you know, literally get considered like the greatest films of the silent era. That's kind of what our list has been so far. Even just looking at that, you kind of get like such a broader perspective on these things and kind of where the history is. And I don't know, it does kind of make me just go like, nobody knows anything, like we're the experts, go fuck yourselves, like movie critics.
At the end of the day, it comes back down to personal preference and personal interpretation of film. There's definitely consensus on certain films, you know, but even then there's always the minority that doesn't like those films that fall into the consensus, you know, or the thoughts about certain films that are in consensus. There's always a minority voice on that. And in the end of the day, it comes down to your own personal thoughts and feelings about what you've watched. And that's what I liked about doing this is, you know, I don't have anybody telling me what I'm supposed to think about film. You know, fuck you if you're trying to tell me what I'm supposed to think about this film. We're watching these films, and I at least hope that we're coming into this earnestly. I hope that comes off in the podcast. And we've been really enjoying just doing this and seeing all this great stuff in these films from this early era. And yeah, it feels like it's been ignored by a lot of people who are so-called film experts. And
I mean, how many greatest film lists have you seen that have included Hacksaw as on that list? And I would put that as like one of the greatest films I've ever seen, quite honestly. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, yeah, no, same here. And I mean, and us doing that doesn't make it true. It's just, it makes it our personal experience with that film.
Sure.
And I mean, that's where I think the conversation should be. It shouldn't be from someone talking down to other people about, oh no, this is how film is. This is what real film technique is. And so it's like, no, it always has to be from, you know, personal perspective and have a conversation about it with someone else with a personal perspective of the film. Right. And not, you know, as much as there's a lot of consensus of like certain films, you can't make that set in stone.
Like, I mean, there is a no gods, no masters element to this where, you know, it's not, you know, like you and I are not the experts, but like, no. Ultimately, nobody is the experts. Like there are people who have seen like tens of thousands of movies, and there are people who have done like, and I really respect people who have done, graduate work, who have done real studies of film to the degree that they have like insightful things to say and like, oh, go check this out and go do that thing. I think what we're kind of landing on, and I'm sorry to not, we're not really talking about the movie anymore. We're just kind of talking in general, but I think what we're trying to land on is like, there's an element of aristocracy where certain films get considered worth viewing. Like there's a list of movies where you look at this list of movies, and when you've seen this list of like 200 films and you've read this list of like 25 books, suddenly you are an expert on movies. And who gets left in and left out of that conversation is a complicated thing. And I think what we're running into is like, we're viewing all this stuff and we're finding that there are things left out of that narrative precisely because like there's no one really looking at silent film beyond like, Charlie Chaplin. And who gets included in that sort of mainstream narrative?
Yeah, you know, guidelines are fine. Like here's a person who's gone to film school and has, you know, researched and knows all the background on all these films, and here's their personal 20 best films ever made.
Mm-hmm.
And you read that list, that's great, but it's not set in stone. It is a introduction for some people because there's probably stuff that they've never heard of on there, but you know, it's just a starting point. It's just a vector into exploration of film. And like I feel like, you know, like I'm saying, this hanging scene in this film, I cannot think of any fucking list of films ever where I've seen anyone mention this shit. Like I've never seen anyone mention like greatest film scenes ever. I've never seen, the hanging scene.
Like it's, I mean, it kind of brought me to tears watching that.
It's profoundly sad and poetic and amazing. And
I mean, both of these films, I think it's worth noting that both of these films are incredibly dark.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of like, despite the fact that In Old Arizona is kind of a comedy, and this one is less so, but both of these films have like this really dark heart, and both of these films are kind of late 20s pre Great Depression. Oh my God, we're gonna kind of come back to this era of film, and suddenly get to explore the Great Depression. That's gonna be great for everyone, right?
Yeah.
But it is worth noting that, like, these films do not shy away from the darkness. There is a moment in this film, in The Virginian, where our schoolmarm, who, I love her.
She's great. She is great.
Yeah, she's great. Runs across a group of children, and they're hanging one of their classmates in kind of a, pretend way. Mm-hmm. And it's like, oh, no, we're just play acting the hanging that we saw. You know, yeah, it turned out, Richard Arlen. He died. Yeah,
the hung Steve.
Yeah, the hung Steve. And we're just play acting that, which is a very thing that kids do, and also a very thing that people who work with children kind of run across and have to deal with. Like, mm-hmm. It's a very real moment. Even in 2020, that felt very real to me. That said, you know, it is like, well, and these are children who are miming hanging one of their schoolmates, because this is just kind of a reality of the world they live in. And it is a kind of reflection of the violence that existed in American society, and in particular society in this time and place, and at that era of like, yeah, there's just a lynching. We're just going to do a lynching. That's just a thing, you know?
Yeah.
Although not technically a lynching, because, our lead is a member of the government, so it's not, it's complicated.
He's not a minority.
Yeah, I mean, lynching is one of those things, like, hopefully we can talk about lynching another time, but, like, it's late, and I'm tired and drunk, and I feel like we both have and have not talked about this movie enough.
It's something people need to watch. It's pretty great.
It's very good. And I would love to see, one of the things that I would like to see from this, if the studio is listening to our podcast, which gets 100 listeners, is put out a big restored version of this, because I'd buy it. All of our listeners would, I'm sure.
Yeah, you would get guaranteed 102 sales of this film if you put it on DVD remastered.
Like one percent of people on a podcast will listeners to a podcast will actually spend money on a thing, so you will get one $20 sale, but also two, because both Lee and I would buy it.
So three, definitely.
You will get three sales. You will make $60 if you,
which probably wouldn't nearly cover the cost of like remastering it.
Yeah. If you pay someone for 80 hours of I don't know how many hours it takes to remaster, but I'd love to get a good version of this. And post-capitalism, someone will do this because this movie deserves better work. I'd do it.
Thinking just a couple things here just sort of struck me. There's a scene where they're rustling the cattle and they put them in the river. I'm kind of thinking some of them didn't make it.
Like, oh yeah, that seemed like a bunch of dead beef.
Yeah.
This is how we feed the crew. We're just gonna like drown some cows and then like slaughter and cook them.
And fire. I like the I like the comedy drunk side character who's like always like, let's get a drink. And they're at the social there where, everyone's hanging out, and he's like, he's always talking about how America's changing and how it's so bad that he's going to have to leave soon. And he's like, pretty soon they've been putting soda pop in the liquor. And it's like, wow, he predicted Bud Light Lime. Like prophetic right there, great stuff.
Yeah, just like scotch and soda, that's a sign of the collapse of Western civilization. Yeah.
A little bit of trivia here.
I mean, any time that people are pouring whiskey in a Western, like, I understand that, on screen, this is like real whiskey, but in reality, you just imagine this is like fermented cactus. That's what was really being poured.
Yeah, because whiskey was not whiskey back then. It was anything you could distill.
This was effectively like you would go blind drinking this. Like, this is there's a reason people died at 35.
Yeah, and I mean the stuff you would be buying at taverns, like, it would be so watered down, because if it wasn't, you would kill people, like legit kill people with a lot of that stuff.
Well, and there's a reason that like beer just didn't exist. I mean, you and I both come out of the kind of the beer geek world, right? You know, and I'm sure most of our fans understand that. But there's a reason in the Western states that beer didn't exist, and that's because it didn't travel well. And, you know, it was more cost efficient to just distill. And so you just take whatever sugar source you have, which is, you know, cactus or just grain alcohol, pure sugar, or, you know, potatoes or whatever. And you would just distill it and then you'd serve it. And so, like, the idea that, like, this is whiskey that we have both, like, you know, distilled properly and then like aged properly in a barrel, like you know, that's not the reality of what we're seeing in taverns in 1880 in Arizona.
There were no whiskey laws back then. It was like you have to age it for 3 years and shit. It's like, no,
they weren't doing that. Like, this is great whiskey. This is like, at best, they had some grain that they distilled and then they turned it into white whiskey. So this is like white lightning at best, and like most likely methanol infused cactus water.
A little bit of trivia here. There was also a 1962 spinoff series for television from this, apparently. This was actually issued in a silent version as well. So,
interesting.
Yeah. So apparently there was like a full version with like title cards, which is something I need to see. Like, I need to find this.
Ironically, the other one, in old Arizona, would work much better as a silent film than this one.
Yeah,
really, you'd have to like cut out most of the jokes.
Yeah, really. Yeah,
you know, like now, in old Arizona, does feel like it's a silent film in which, like, oh, and then we have like a little 5 minute segment where we're just gonna tell jokes. Like, which it works better if you see it that way, honestly.
Yeah, know? Yeah.
Whereas this feels like a sound film. Like, it'd be hard for me to imagine a silent version like working as well as a sound version does.
Yeah. So this was, of course, Gary Cooper's first all talking film. And I love that. Like, I was looking at the posters for this, like the vintage posters.
Yep.
It's like all talking film. Like, they put it right on the posters, all talking film, you know, like this is great. He felt that sound would ruin him, believing his voice was not adequate to the task. And this film turned him from a promising young leading man to a star, though. Although he was not considered a superstar until Mr. Deeds Goes to Town in 1936, apparently. So, yeah. This is one of over 700 Paramount Productions filmed between 1929 and 1949. Wow, they did 700 between there. Which were sold to MCA Universal in 1958 for television distribution and have been owned and controlled by MCA ever since. And the last little bit here, and this is kind of notable, just because this guy is a major Western actor, iconic Western actor, I'd say. Randolph Scott has a bit role in here, uncredited, with no lines, as just like a cowhand or whatever.
Sure.
In some spot. But Randolph Scott is like an all-time
great. I think as we get through the 20s and 30s, we'll run into that a lot.
And I say that
because, like, it's just objectively true that, like, a whole lot of people who ended up being like huge stars are like, you know, I was an uncredited like background actor in like such and such thing from 1932 that probably doesn't exist anymore, you know.
Right.
Think about like Arnold Schwarzenegger in The Long Goodbye, where he has like, you know, two lines. He's in like one scene, and then like he becomes like the biggest movie star of all time for 10 years. Yeah.
So yeah, we're getting into a time machine. We got a little time machine here. We're gonna jump ahead.
Yeah, we have a TARDIS or a DeLorean or a phone booth. Regardless of how you feel about whatever your time machine metaphor is, we're going to pretend that the years between 1929 and 1985 don't exist and just jump forward.
Yeah, let's do TARDIS because I want like some attractive Doctor Who seconds, and of course the TARDIS has a swimming pool in it.
Yeah, well, if you believe the Moffat years are real, which I do not, but, you know.
I'm game for the swimming pool thing. I don't care about the rest of the Moffat shit, because that's all bullshit, but...
Yeah. Except Karen Gillan. She's fine to continue to be a, you know... Like, mm-hmm. Who's your favorite Doctor Who companion?
Ace.
Ace. In terms of attractiveness, in terms of, like, sexiness. Because we're just going to be, like, misogynistic.
I mean, you might think I'd gravitate towards, like, the later redheads, but you know what? I might still say Ace.
Ace is great. Ace is definitely on my list. Like,
I feel like, isn't it like Zoe? Isn't she like a little too young? Maybe
Zoe's like 19. Like the
okay,
yeah.
Okay, well then I don't feel too bad about that then.
There's no one underage.
Okay, good. Good. Yeah. I was actually worried about that for a second.
I think the character is supposed to be younger, but like.
But timey wimey stuff. Yeah, whatever. Yeah,
it's fine.
Yeah. So it's a toss up between Zoe and Ace, and hey, they could both get in the swimming pool. As far as I'm concerned, I don't care.
Well, sure. I mean, the more the merrier. Ultimately, yeah. No, it's fine.
But yeah, we're going to 1985, and it's episode 200, and like we've been kind of doing for this on monumental episodes. We're going back to our namesake. We're going back to George Romero. We're going back to the Dead series. And we're going to be looking at Day of the Dead. And actually, that's probably going to be the last Romero Dead film we're going to do in this podcast.
Maybe for 300, we'll do a Diary.
Diary?
400. Just jump.
You want to jump to Diary and to skip Land of the Dead?
Is Land before... Land is before Diary, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's right, yeah. Well, let's skip the next 50 and like decide at 300 if we want to kind of continue to Romero.
That works. If we're still here at 300,
that's at least 2 years away. So
yeah. Like so, yeah. But yeah, we're gonna be doing Day of the Dead, and hopefully we'll have Paul back. Potentially, we'll have some guests as well. I was talking with my friend Ricky Morgan and Johnny Krug from Short Butts Cinema. And I just recently did an episode with them, and they're like, we both love that film. Maybe we could arrange to get on it. So we're going to try to make that work. So maybe, possibly, it won't be next week that we do this. If we can, like, get the schedules copacetic, maybe it'll take 2 weeks. Who knows? But I'm going to try to make that happen. So should be a big episode. Should be a lot of fun. And then we're going to, like, you know, sort of dilly-dally in the 80s for a little while, for a month or something.
I think the goal is to sort of like take a little bit of a break from the black and white silent early stuff and kind of hit some stuff that people might have seen already in the 80s and 90s. And my plan is to kind of let Lee kind of pick some of that stuff. And
cool. You know,
because we're a little bit light in terms of our conversation about movies in the 80s and 90s. And so, I've put some stuff on the list. There are a couple of films that I'm going to kind of say, like, yeah, let's do this. But mm-hmm. we're just going to do, like, 4 weeks of, like, yeah, let's bounce around there and then kind of come back to the late 20s, early 30s after that. So the whole idea is you don't go backwards unless you... Going forward. Yeah.
Like, yeah.
So, yeah. So, yeah. So we'll pick back up on the films of this era in another, you know, 4 or 5 episodes. But, you know, we got 200. We got to do Romero. Like,
yeah. That's what we do.
Ultimately, I would rather be doing like the Crazies to be doing Day of the Dead.
Oh my God. The Crazies is so...
like Day of the Dead is so not my favorite Romero movie.
Well, let's see what you think once you rewatch
it. I haven't rewatched it in a number of years, so we'll rewatch it. I'm looking forward to doing the episode, but I love Romero. Day of the Dead is not where I go. Look at Romero.
And I'd say if you're going for a film that's like more like of the time right now, David Cronenberg's Rabid is actually much more on point right now for what's going on. because that's about a it's ostensibly a vampire movie. Like it's Marilyn Chambers, the porn star who actually, you know, did some mainstream acting for a while.
Yep.
And she's actually really good. She gets into a motorcycle accident and this private, non-socialized clinic, you know, like this private clinic does some skin grafts on her that are, new futuristic skin grafts that basically turn her into a vampire-like creature that spreads a virus. So she spreads like a pandemic in Montreal, here in Canada. And lo and behold, socialized medicine saves the day.
Well, as also it does in real life. So
yeah, and shuts down the pandemic. It's actually much more apt right now for what's going on right now in the world.
I feel like we need to make this happen.
Hey, maybe the time machine will get into a hiccup and we'll hit rabid before we do the rest of the 80s.
I think that's probably worth doing. I've been kind of like trying to like not talk about the pandemic while we're in the midst of it.
Mm-hmm.
Just to make this podcast a little bit more, fun.
Okay, well, and, let's table that for like the future then, like after this is breezed over.
After this is over, yeah. Like in 2022, we'll cover that because, this is the darkest timeline and we're all going to die.
Yeah. So, Daniel, tell people where they can find you on the interwebs.
You can find me on Twitter. I'm at Daniel E. Harper. I do a podcast called I Don't Speak German. I can't imagine anyone is listening to this who hasn't heard this like 100 times or more. But I do a podcast called I Don't Speak German, which is about Nazis and about Nazi ideology and how terrible they are. Because when I'm not talking about goofy sex comedies and talking about 1929 titties, I am tracking the worst people in the English-speaking world. And I do a podcast about that, and I think it's really important, and you should listen if you feel, you know, we tell a lot of jokes as well. It's fun. Mm-hmm. It's fun. It's a fun show. And it's about genocidal racists. So this is how I sell the thing that I have spent 4 years of my life doing. Is like, yeah, it's cute, it's fun, it's fine. You will not want to slit your wrist after most of the time. And it's also about like the worst people in the world. Congratulations. So
it's a little bit of Mel Brooks making fun of Nazis, but at the same time it's much more serious and information based.
Right.
There you go.
I will teach you what you need to know to confront them in your real life. That's kind of the goal. And most of the time I think we do a pretty good job of it. So, yeah.
I would agree. Yes. And you can find us at tmbdos.podbean.com, where you can find our Apple Podcasts, Facebook, and YouTube links. And, yeah, thank you very much, Daniel. Thank you, everyone, for listening. Thanks for sticking with us with, you know, every once in a while. We've sort of been taking breaks here in the last little while. Just because essential service job bullshit, where it's just like, I don't have the energy.
Lee works for a grocery store, and I work in the pharma industry. And Lee is clearly more important than I am.
I'm a hero, apparently. Yeah, I'm a pandemic hero.
I actually unironically agree. Like, you're doing amazing work.
But I'm being, because, again, I'm in socialist utopia, Nova Scotia. I'm being paid very well for being a pandemic hero right now. So, right. Don't feel too great about me, guys.
It turns out that Lee and I are both essential workers, despite the fact that we don't get paid very well. But
but we'll take the little scrapings that the that the upper class throws.
It turns out that all of our bosses get to work from home. And avoid any personal strife aside from
they all get to work from home and vote Republican. That's what they get to do.
That's exactly what they get to do. And we get to vote for Bernie.
Hopefully. Which is what you should do, but
vote Bernie. Or Bernie is the center right candidate, but further left than Bernie. No, it's fine. This episode is over. Nobody's listening.
It's fucking ridiculous. Yeah. Thank you all guys for listening, and we'll see you next time. Goodbye.
Cheers.
Oh, bury me not on the lone prairie. These words came low and mournfully from the pallid lips of a youth who lay on his dying bed at the close of day. Oh, bury me not on the lone prairie where the coyote howls and the wind blows free in a narrow grave just 6x3. Matters not, so I've been told, where the body lies when the heart grows cold. Yet grant, oh grant this wish to me.
You've been listening to They Must Be Destroyed on Sight. For other episodes, our links to Apple Podcasts, YouTube, and our Facebook group, as well as links to podcasts and websites of similar interest, please visit us at tmbdos.podbean.com. Thank you. Drive through.